Welcome to our Evensong. This is a strange way of communicating with each other, but we know that you're there, and it is lovely once again to have you all with us, even though you're remote, and look forward to having you here again when we all can reconvene. Thank you.
Beloved, we are come together in the presence of Almighty God and of the whole company of heaven to offer unto him through our Lord Jesus Christ our worship and praise and thanksgiving, to make confession of our sins, to pray as well for others as for ourselves, that we may know more truly the greatness of God's love and show forth in our lives the fruits of his grace, and to ask on behalf of all people such things as their well-being doth require. Therefore, let us continue in a moment of shared silence and remember God's presence with us now. As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
O Lord, open thou our lips, and our mouths shall show forth thy praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Praise ye the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. Joyful in the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Be sure that the Lord
verses 1 to 15. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the Tabernacle of Mamre. As Abraham was sitting at the opening of his tent in the heat of the day, he looked up and saw three men standing in front of him. When he saw them, he ran from the opening of his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. "Sirs," he said, "I have deserved your favor. Do not pass by my humble self without a visit. Let me send for some water so that you may wash your feet and rest under a tree, and let me fetch a little food so that you may refresh yourselves. Afterwards, you may continue the journey which has brought you my way." They said, "Do by all means as you say." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah and said, "Take three measures of flour quickly. Knead it and make some cakes." Then Abraham ran to the cattle, chose a fine, tender calf, and gave it to a servant who hurriedly prepared it. He took curds and milk and the calf he had prepared and set it before them and waited on them himself under the tree while they ate. They asked him where Sarah, his wife, was, and he explained that she was in the tent. The stranger said, "About this time next year, I will be sure to come back to you, and Sarah, your wife, shall have a son." Now Sarah was listening at the opening of the tent, and he was close beside it. So both Abraham and Sarah had grown very old, and Sarah was past the age of childbearing. "Now that I am out of my time and my husband is old, the Lord said to Abraham, 'Why did Sarah laugh and say, shall I indeed bear a child when I am old? Is anything impossible for the Lord? In due season I will come back to you about this time of year, and Sarah shall have a son.' Sarah lied because she was frightened and denied that she had laughed. But he said, 'Yes, you did laugh.' Now here endeth the lesson."
Strength with
was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
Taken from the letter to the Romans, chapter 5, verses 1 to 8. Therefore, now that we have been justified through faith, let us continue in peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have been allowed to enter the sphere of God's grace where we now stand. Let us exult in the hope of the divine splendour that is to be ours. More than this, let us even exult in our present sufferings, because we know that suffering trains us to endure, and endurance brings proof that we have stood the test. And this proof is the ground of hope. Such a hope is no mockery, because God's love has flooded our inmost heart through the Holy Spirit he has given us. For at the very time when we were still powerless, then Christ died for the wicked. Even for a just man, one of us would hardly die, though perhaps for a good man, one might actually brave death. But Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that is God's own proof of his love towards us. Here endeth the second lesson.
So let us say together the words of the Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
O Lord, show thy mercy upon us, and grant us thy salvation. O Lord, save the Queen, and mercifully hear us when we call upon thee. Endure thy ministers with righteousness, and make thy chosen people joyful. O Lord, save thy people, and bless thine inheritance. Give peace in our time, O Lord, because there is none other that fighteth for us, but only thou, O God. O God, may clean our hearts within us, and take not thy Holy Spirit from us.
The Collect for the First Sunday after Trinity. O God, the strength of all those who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers, and because through the weakness of our mortal nature we can do no good thing without you, grant us the help of your grace, that in the keeping of your commandments we may please you both in will and deed. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen. Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please. Hello friends, how good to be with you for worship today. Let's begin in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The Lord said to Sarah, "Oh yes, you did laugh." There is really no point, Scripture suggests, in trying to outwit God. Whether you're Adam or Eve, Jonah or Sarah, he sees and hears, we are reminded. Sarah's laugh is one of the most important outbursts in the whole of the Bible and captures the sense that this story, above all, is a divine comedy. And not, in spite of everything grievous it contains, a divine tragedy. As you will know, the difference between comedy and tragedy in classical theatre is not so much the content as the climax of the drama. Is the outcome ultimately one of life or of death? To which question, Scripture emphatically replies, life. Behold, says the risen Christ at the end of Scripture, I am making all things new. As St. Paul expresses so subtly in our epistle reading today, there is a route, albeit a long and winding one, through suffering, which does not deny its reality or appalling pain. Does not deny the reality of death. After all, the symbol of our faith is the cross, but which leads beyond it, through it. Let me read to you from Romans 5, verses 3 to 5. And not only that, writes Paul, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Hope does not disappoint us. Now here, as elsewhere in his letters, St. Paul portrays the work of the Holy Spirit as a kind of guide, one who has been to the summit and comes to walk alongside us, drawing us forward by his wisdom, by his knowledge of the way of Christ. A couple of years ago, we climbed Snowdon as a family and were glad to have on that adventure someone who knew the path well and could assure us when it was heavy going, we couldn't even see the end. In fact, we mistook one of the lower foothills for Snowdon itself. And when we rounded the corner and did see the summit that soaring before us, and my children just sort of deflated visibly before me, they could assure us, it's all right, it's perfectly possible. We will get there. And indeed we did. And the gasping laughter at the view, the panorama, was tremendous. Hope does not disappoint us in the end. For Sarah and Abraham, advanced in age, the idea that she might bear a son was preposterous, a physical impossibility, apart from anything. And so Sarah's laugh is, like all laughter, a recognition of the abyss between how things are and how they might be. It's a recognition, like all laughter, at the shortfall between ideal and reality. So when in chapter 20 her son is born, what does she name him but Isaac, which means in Hebrew, laughter? For as she says, God has brought laughter for me, brought Isaac for me, and everyone who hears will laugh with me. This laugh, planted deep within Israel's history, is a signal, a signpost to the end of the journey, an anticipation of the end here and now, like that the bag of sweets that we carry for our children on a long walk. It's a sign and a sustenance that we will get there. Every true blessing is like this, I think. Elsewhere, St. Paul calls the Holy Spirit the foretaste of the kingdom, as if he were the, like an hors d'oeuvre of the heavenly banquet. Now we know, some of you all too well, that these weeks of confinement and crisis have brought for many much more weeping than laughter, and times when it has not been impossible to smile, let alone laugh, not possible to see the way ahead. And yet into these very places and times, into the very teeth of the human tragedy, God sends his relief, the Son, who lives and dies among us, for us, dies our death, and the Spirit, that great guide of God, to lead us through to where laughter and life, not disappointment and loss, are our destination. May it be so, for Jesus' sake. Amen.
So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gift of life that we have received through the sacrifice of your own Son, Jesus. Your love opens the way to all. Fill your church with your love. Guide her leaders in this place and throughout the world, that they may be true witnesses of your love and care for all. Give them strength in supporting their communities in different ways in these difficult times. You, O Lord, are our hope and our joy. Father, we give you thanks for the diversity and richness in our world. We pray for all who feel oppressed by difference in race, creed, or colour. We pray for peace among your children and guidance and courage for those in positions of leadership in these sensitive times. You, O Lord, are our hope and our joy. We pray for the leadership of our country, giving thanks for the steadfast faith of our Queen Elizabeth. And we pray for all ministers in her government and members of the Parliament during this time of COVID-19. We pray your guidance on them in the difficult decisions that have to be made. You, O Lord, are our hope and our joy. Father, we give you thanks for the experience of Abraham and Sarah, the assurance that you keep your promises to us. We thank you for the joy of families and friends. We pray for those that we love and worry about, and those who love and worry about us, and commend one another to your keeping. We especially hold before you the many who are sick at this time with the virus and other conditions. May your presence strengthen them and their loved ones. You, O Lord, are our hope and our joy. Father, we thank you for all the medical research that is trying to find a way forward in this crisis. We pray for all who work in our hospitals, hospices, and clinics, and for all patients in their care. We pray for all key workers preserving our daily life. You, O Lord, are our hope and our joy. Father, we thank you for all who have lived your praise and worked for the coming of your kingdom. Receive into the joy of heaven all those who have died in faith, whose strong hope in the eternal God has been fulfilled. So we pray a prayer of St. Chrysostom. Almighty God, who hast given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.